Let me just remind, there is a member seminar today at 2 that has at least, if you don't know about quantum ergodicity, you at least know about large regular graphs. They will also feature in there.
Okay, so I don't promise that it will be funny, but I will talk about inferences, traces, tribes, and threshold, so some new examples. And maybe I will just give you as a, so this will be fairly, so this will be about Boolean function and some questions about inferences of variables on Boolean functions. And let me give you also as an alternative some unrelated questions that maybe that I wrote about it and which I think is also nice. And this is the following question. So as you know, every a planar graph, so this is a geometry question, a planar graph with E edges with V vertices and E edges, so a planar simple graph with V vertices and E edges satisfies that E is less or equal than 3V. Actually, you can write here 3V minus 6. So this is a well-known consequence of Euler's theorem, and even this particular theorem maybe can tract fairly directly to Descartes' writing on polytopes, so it looks very basic, and it's also very useful. So some more advanced results in discrete geometry, like the so-called crossing lemma and consequence of the crossing lemma, are descendant of this theorem. And there is a conjecture which is very similar, which says the following: if K is a simplicial two-dimensional complex, and K can be embedded in R4, and if K has E edges and F two-dimensional faces, then F is less or equal than 4E. Okay, so here there was E less or equal than 3V, and here the conjecture is that F is less or equal than 4E. This is a very simple-minded conjecture, and it's not known, even if you replace here the number 4 by any constant. So F less or equal than some constant times E is also not known. You can, yeah, you can achieve 4e, yeah. You can achieve that the ratio will turn out to 4. Yeah. So this is a very nice, simple-minded, nice question that, okay. So I'll talk about Boolean functions, and so I will, mainly I would like to mention some joint, very recent joint work with Jeff Kahn, who is a long-time collaborator of me, where we described an old conjecture by Benny Shor from 1989, from the early days of inferences. And I will also briefly mention another work with Jeff from a few years ago and some older examples by Saron Shelach and me and by Bolobash and Redcliffe. Okay, so let's see how it goes. So the first part is the KKL theorem and Shor's, Benny Shor's conjecture. So the discrete n-dimensional cube, I will start by talking about the discrete n-dimensional cube and Boolean functions. Of course, if there are questions or remarks, please interrupt me at any time. The discrete n-dimensional cube, omega n, is the set of 0, 1 vectors of length n. The uniform probability distribution of omega n is denoted by mu. A Boolean function is simply a map from omega n to 0, 1. And for a Boolean function f, we denote mu of f as the measure of all the, of the set of x so that f of x is 1. So mu of f is a number between 0 and 1. And a Boolean function is monotone if f cannot decrease when you switch a coordinate from 0 to 1. So this is the notion of Boolean function. Of course, Boolean functions are very important in combinatorics, which is where I come from, and also in theoretical computer science, and in they appear in probability theory and some models, stochastic models from various places, even in game theory, in voting methods. So they are fairly basic objects. And here is a notion which will be quite important for us. This is the influence of variables. So we start with the function sigma k, which sigma k is simply the function which switches the value of the k's coordinate. So sigma k of a vector is the same, except you switch the value of the k's coordinate from xk to 1 minus xk. And the influence of the k's variable on Boolean function is defined by ik of f is the probability that the probability over all points in the discrete cube that when you switch the value of the k's coordinate, you change the value of the function. So this is the influence of the k's variable. I will mention a few related, perhaps related notions in a minute. And now there is a more general notion. I should say that this notion, so there is a more general notion that were considered by Ben-Or and Lineal. And Michael Ben-Or and Nati Lineal, in a paper from 1995, they defined various notions of influence, not only on Boolean functions, but on more general protocols, where this protocol, their motivation was to get a collective coin flipping. So the motivation came from the following problem. You have n processors, and you want to create a random bit collectively. And each processor can, so Boolean function can give you a very simple protocol where each processor gives you a random bit, and the collective random bit is the Boolean function of all these random bits. But they considered much more general protocols where you can have several rounds, and every processor will contribute random bits in various rounds, and then at the end, the outcome will be the bit of the protocol. And they were interested in protocols which are immune to a set of agents or processors which try to bias the outcome. So if everybody behave as expected, then the probability will be half and half. But if there is a set of processors that try to influence the outcome to be one, then they consider the notion of what is the influence of this set of processors, and the purpose was to find protocols where this influence can be suppressed as much as possible. And this led to the following definition for Boolean function. So the influence of a set of variables toward one, is plus of f, is the probability over all the coordinates not in S. So you assign values at random to the coordinate not in S, and the probability that there exists an assignment for the coordinate in S, so that when you put these two assignments together, you get one. So here FUV is a little abuse of notation. It means that for the places not in S, you take U, and for the places in S, you take V. And from this quantity, you have to subtract mu of f. So this is what is the excess. If the variable, if the processor which corresponds to the variables in S can wait and see what the others are doing, and they want to influence the outcome as much as possible toward one, this is how they can bias it further than the measure of f is to start with. So this is the influence toward one of this set of variables. And mainly for most of the purpose of the talk, this minus mu of f is a term that we can disregard. It's only obscure matter. But this is the way it appeared in the original definition. And also, it's related to the notion of overall influence. And here is similar the influence toward zero. So this is the probability that when you assign the values outside S at random, then there is an assignment for the variables in S so that the outcome is zero. And from this, you have to subtract 1 minus mu of F, which is the probability that F is zero to start with. So this is the two notions of influence of sets that Ben-Ori Lineal defined. Oops. And another important thing from their paper is a simple observation that you can replace the function g by a monotone Boolean function f so that the measure will be the same and all the influences will not increase, will be smaller or equal. So is plus of f is smaller or equal to is plus of g, and so in some sense you can reduce questions about influence if you want to minimize the influence to questions about a monotone Boolean function. And the monotonicity for Boolean function, it's a very important property, and it sounds very innocent, but it's fairly subtle and deep to understand what monotonicity give us in various cases. What? Yes, this is an easy inductive process, which sometimes called shifting. You just do it coordinate by coordinate. So you look at the coordinate I, you look at all the places where switching the value, the I's coordinate change the value of the function. In some of these coordinates, it go against the monotonicity, so we just switch the values. So if there is a place where with one you get zero and with zero you get one, so there are two values, two assignments with opposite values, just switch the value of this function. And this operation does not change the influence of this particular variable. It decreases all the influence of the other variables, and it also decreases all this influence of large sets. So this is a simple argument. Okay. So here is the theorem of Jeff Kahn, myself, and Nati Lineal from 88. There exists a variable k, so that the influence of this variable is greater or equal to the measure of f times 1 minus the measure of f times log n over n. So the interesting case from the point of view of Michael and Ben-Or work was the case that the measure is 1/2. And here, the surprising ingredient is this log n. I will explain why this log n is surprising, but this was the new ingredient. And here is a sharp version that maybe I'll write without explaining. So one aspect of this sharp version is that I replaced the uniform measure by a more general Bernoulli measure. So this is one ingredient. And the other ingredient that this is something which tells you something about all the vector of influences which capture in the optimal way this result. It tells you if you take the influences and divide them by log of the influences, then this is at least a constant depending on p. Where let's forget about p, and for our purpose p is 1/2, but it's a constant. It's greater or equal than a constant times the measure of the function times 1 minus the measure of the function. So this is a very nice way to give you, to extract the optimal information coming from this theorem and the proof. So I don't want to discuss the proof of this theorem and the direction which came out from the proof, but here are some consequences of this theorem when you talk about influences of larger sets. And these consequences are obtained by iterating. You know, you find one variable which has log n over n influence, then you apply its influence, and then in the resulting Boolean function, you find another variable, and you continue, and you get, and this is what you get. So what you get is that for every b greater than zero, there is a constant, so that if you start with a Boolean function with measure about 1/2 or bounded away from 0 and 1, then there is a set S of constant time n variables, so that the influence is 1 minus 1 over n to the c. So it's It's not one, but it's close to one in a polynomial way, 1 over n to the c. And there you can also start with a function f, which is where the measure to start with is not a constant, but 1 over some constant, n to some constant, some small constant. And you can reach a set of constant n variables so that the influence is 1 minus a little of 1. And you can do these things together. So if you have a function of measure 1 over n to the, 1 over 10, then you can find a set of variables, maybe 30% of the variables, so that the influence toward 1, so the total influence is greater or equal to 1 minus 1 over n to the power 1 over 10, something like that. So this is this is what happens if you apply iteratively this result about individual variables. But of course, in many cases, we don't necessarily believe that the best way to prove result about large set is to iterate what we can say about individual variables. And this is also in this case. And this led Benishaw to make the following conjecture. He conjectured that the situation is you can get much, much stronger influence. For every b greater than 0, there is some c greater than 1. So that if you start with a function where mu of f is 1/2, you can find a set S of bn variables so that the influence of this set of variables is greater or equal to 1 minus something which is exponentially small with respect to some constant to the n. Okay, so this was the conjecture. This was conjecture from 1989. And there was another conjecture from the same time. I don't remember who made this conjecture. I'll tell you a little bit where you can find this conjecture. And this says that if you start with a function whose measure is exponentially small, but not, say, the measure is 0.99999 to the n, then you can already find a set of 20% of the variable so that the total influence is large. And maybe I'll make one remark. If you want a set of more than half the variables, then you can have total influence, which is 1. And this is this follows from a famous theorem by the so-called Sauer-Schellach lemma. And I will mention the connection. But the point is that here is that the number of variables, the set of variables you want to be influential, is a set of variables with less than half, left with a constant, but a constant less than 1/2 of all the variables. Okay. So this was a Benishaw conjecture, and actually it it didn't appear in print, and the only place we found it written is in an old grant proposal of Natty Lineal from 1989, and then it also appeared in my blog in 2006, and So this
now finally it will appear in your paper.
Yeah. Okay. So it will appear in my So here is this is what we managed to prove. We managed to prove this is not correct. So
does he know that he conjectured it?
Yeah. So not only the Benny knows that he conjectured it, but every time I come to Tel Aviv, I usually mention this conjecture, and. Recently, I gave a talk in Tel Aviv University, and I didn't mention this conjecture, but it was a talk about an entirely different field. So I told him, Benny, this time I didn't mention your conjecture. He said, come on, this is an entirely different field. But I said, no, but also we solved the conjecture. So he was very happy. Yeah. I should say that Benny Shore and Gereb Strauss, I think, they proved some result which come quite close to our result with Jeff and Natty. They proved 3 over n, so 3 is much smaller than log n, but essentially to get log n you need two ingredients, and they had one of the ingredients which enabled them to push it to 3 and not the other one. Okay, so it turns out that both these conjectures are false, and that you cannot get better. So if you have a function whose measure is 1/2 and you are interested in the inference toward 1, you cannot get better than 1 over n to the c. What? Yeah, well, I'll mention it. Here you have a function whose measure is 1/2. You see, I carry this obscure thing in the definition, but if you have a function of measure 1/2, what we show is that if you try to influence it, if you try to get the probability will be close to 1 by setting the values of a constant number of variables, you cannot get closer than a polynomial than a 1 over n to some large constant. So Yeah, but this is you see, there was the plus. Here we add both the plus and the minus, and this gives us this 1. Now the counter example is already for the plus, so we don't have to worry about the minus. Okay? So yeah, this is this piece of notation which is, so in particular, is of f without the plus is less or equal than 1 minus 1 over n to the c. So this is slightly stronger statement. So we cannot do better apart from the identity of this constant, we cannot do better than iterating the inference of individual variables. And this is a similar theorem about when we start with a small set. If we start with a set whose measure is 1 minus epsilon to the n, then we can find such a function so that for every set of variables, even if this set is very large and contain 1/2 minus delta times n of the variables, the influence of this set of variables is exponentially small in a power of n. So it's very tiny. We wanted it to be 1 minus a little of 1, but we cannot. It's not 2, the original conjecture. So this says to. Okay, so this does not give the full picture of all the possible questions you can ask, but for a large number of questions, it says the method of iterating the inference of a single variable cannot be improved because there are examples. And now I want to describe to you examples. This is the part 2 of the talk, and it's called Tribes, Try Tribes 1. It starts with, again, a very basic example by Ben Ori Linear, which is called the tribe example. And the tribe example is a function of the form or. You take the or on m, you have on m events, and then each ci is the end of k variables. Okay, this is a tribe example. So it's slightly more general than what they considered, but you take the OR over a collection sets of variables of expression where each expression is the end over k variables. Very, very simple. Yeah, so in their case it was disjoint, and now when I talk about general tribe example, I don't insist they are disjoint. And in Benor and Linear example, all the CIs are disjoint set of variables, and they looked at the case where you have this joint set of variable, k is equal to log n minus log n plus a constant, and m is equal to n divided by k. So these variables cover all the variables. You divide all the variables to sets, disjoint sets, and the value of the function is 1 if there, and you call these sets tribes. The value of the function is 1 if all the variables in one of the tribes are all of them are 1, and the value of the function is 0 if in each tribe there is a variable which is 0. So this is the example. It's quite similar to other examples, that natural examples that you can think about. For example, okay, some example, for example,
yeah.
Yeah, so the purpose of this k is that mu of f will be in half. And that the fine tuning tell you that this is should be log n minus log log n plus, I think log log of e or something like that. But you can tune it to make it one half, and this is how you tune it. And actually, we can also talk about the dual tribe example, which is a function of the form where you have n of ci's, where each ci is an or of k variable. And of course, dual tribe and tribe have the same influence. It's just going from the function to 1 minus the function. But sometimes it's convenient to think. And they have slightly different properties when you talk about other, when mu of f is not 1 half. And they are very interesting. And you see them also naturally appearing in other. For example, if you talk about connectivity of random graphs. So connectivity of random graphs does not look like a tribe example. But when you understand it a little better, you know that random graphs are connected precisely when they don't have, in the GNP model, when they don't have isolated vertices. So what does it mean that the graph does not have isolated vertices? You can think about the tribes as the set of edges containing a given vertex. And you need that in each tribe there will be one vote one. So this is so graph connectivity is probabilistically behave the same as no isolating vertices. And the property of having no isolated vertices is a sort of a dual tribe example where the tribes are not disjoint. They are almost disjoint, but they are not entirely disjoint. So you think that this type of tribe example appear also in natural examples. Okay, so this is the tribe example. And now let me mention another very basic theorem, and this theorem explains why the log n in KKL theorem is somewhat surprising. And this is the Harper theorem. This is the very basic isoperimetric result for a Boolean function. And Harper theorem says that if f is a Boolean function and mu of f is t, then I of f is the I of f, which is the sum of the influence of the variables, is always greater or equal to twice t log 1 over t. So this is a useful theorem to know. It's not the most precise form of what can be said. I of f can be described to the optimally for every value of t. So t is some m divided by 2 to the n. You know precisely what will be I of f. But this is a useful form to organize this information. And this log 1 over t is an interesting thing that come here. But you see that from Harper's theorem, it follows, something follows for the individual variables. It follows that the maximum value of an individual variable is at least 2t times log 1 over t divided by n. So if t is 1 half, this gives us the 1 over n. So this is what the KKL theorem improved by a factor of log. If t is not 1 half, then we have to see what is optimal. And when do the KKL information and the Harper information match up? They match up if t is 1 over some polynomial in n. If t is 1 over n to the c, then here you get 2t log log n over n. And KKL theorem also give you t times log n over n. So then the information is the same. And the question is, maybe, so this is still about the influence of individual variable. So the first thing that come to mind, maybe you can improve the result even about the influence of individual variable when t is smaller. Okay, so is it true? This will be certainly be the first way to try to prove better results, to improve the discussion for individual variables. And we can try to look at modified tribe example. I told you that there we had to take k to be log n minus log log n. Now we can take tribes where k is slightly smaller, log n minus 2 log log n plus a constant. And if we make it this small, then the measure of f is 1 minus 1 over n. And then this represents a dual type function. So if the dual type function is that we want one variable to be 1 in each tribe in order that the function is 1. And then this will give us a dual type function where mu of f is 1 over n. And what are the influence? So we make the calculation. Maybe I will not make the calculation, but it's fairly easy. You have to make the calculation. You get log square n over n square. So Harper's theorem gives you log n over n square. And in this particular example, you get log n square over n square. So you may have, so sorry, this is a bit too quick to, but it's a 2 minute calculation. And so this may give you some hope. Maybe we can have a better theorem. Okay, this hope, perhaps KKL can be improved.
White trap example should be the bound example.
No, okay, hope, I said hope. I mean, you know, you get hope for much less, people get hope for much less evidence. But yeah, tribe gave you the right answer for a balanced function. So you can say, okay, this is a variant. And here we see that we gain a, look, this hope will not last long. So I don't want to, okay, so this is a, but you can extend the tribe example in a different way and oh, what did I do? Oh, okay, now here I see I didn't. Okay, so let me do a right. So you can take tribes of the following size of 2 log n. I'm sorry, you see, one reason to put it on record is because whenever I think about it, I got it mixed up between the two examples. I don't remember which one is the good one, which one is the bad one. But I still had it wrong. Well, I had it completely wrong, but then I switch it. And if you take tribe which are 2 log n minus log log n plus c, if this is the right tribe, then mu of f is 1 half. And then, so ignore what's written here. And then the inference is log n over n square. And this means that you cannot improve the Harper what the Harper theorem give you. Sorry about the. So KKL cannot be improved. No. So this is it's strange. This is it's not symmetric because this is a Poisson type distribution. So things are a bit strange. In any case, this is the right number. It's 2 log n minus log log n, and then the tribe give you something. So then you cannot improve the Harper inequality, and this means that if we want to prove Benishaw conjecture or any other result about inference of large number of sets, we need to move directly to argue about large sets. At least this is how it seems. I should say something about another very beautiful example of a Miklos Itay and Nati Lineal, Miki Itay. This is something which was left open both in the paper by Miki and Nati and also in our paper. We wanted to know if when we have a function which is balanced, so mu of f is 1 half, can we always find the set S with a polynomial number of variable, say n to the power 0.99, so that the inference either toward 1 or toward, or toward 0 is 1 half minus little of 1. The best example that was known was a very nice Boolean function that you may be interested in. And this is the recursive majority of SWEs. You divide your variable to 3 groups, and each group to 3 groups, and each group to 3 groups, and each group from 3 groups. And you take majority, and then to triples. And then you take majority of the triples, and then on any triple of triples, you take majority of the outcome, you take majority of the outcome, and so on. And there you can show that you cannot, you have sets of, of size n to some power, I think 0.69, n to the power 0.69, which have influence toward 1 and toward 0, but not below that. And this was a question. And they found an example. So they found a very nice example where you cannot do better. Okay, let me say one more thing. In the tribe example, sorry, this lecture will be around the tribe example. It's, for me, it's very exciting, this example, the tribe example and all the variation. But I can see that I cannot necessarily cause other people to share my excitement. But it's a very nice example. So in any case, in the tribe example, but this is in mathematics in general, it's not so easy to. So in the tribe example, if you want to influence toward 1, you only have to take one tribe, which is log n variables. If you want to influence the outcome toward 0, you need to take essentially one variable from each tribe, which is n over log n variables. So in one direction, you get n over log n, which is a large set. But in the other direction, you get only log n. So our theorem says that you can always have influence, which is very close to 1, with n over log n variables. But and this the tribe example showed that this is best possible. But in one direction, we can do much better. And if you take the dual tribe, then it's the other way around. And the thought was that maybe you can always do something which is a polynomial number of variables in one of the direction. And they show that you cannot do it. So they show that you need n over log square n. So if you want, you have a function that you cannot influence it toward 1, and you cannot influence toward 0 in any meaningful way with less than n over log n square variables. And this is a very nice example. In terms that our examples are this example from the early 90s, but our example is motivated by that. And the idea, let me tell you what are the ideas. The idea is, first of all, you have to replace the variables by literals. What does it mean to replace the variable? You consider some sort of tribes. I will explain it. But you literals means that you consider both variables and the negation of the variables. Then you take a circuit of depth 3. So tribes is circuit of depth 2. So it's ORs of ends, or dual tribes, ends of OR. And they do it 3 times. OR of ends of OR. So you have many partition of the society into tribes, and you want, for example, that so to get 1, you want that in one of these tribes, I'm sorry, that in all of these tribes, there is one tribe that vote 1 or something like that. So end of OR of end of ORs or end of OR of ends. So this is Boolean circuit of depth 3. And then you take a random such example. So these are the ideas. And there is something which is, okay, first of all, this is a very nice idea, but it's even nicer that it works, and it takes some delicate computation. But what is really nice here and mysterious is that we know that there is a monotone example. And we even know that if we have a non-monotone example, we can monotonize it. But this example is not monotone because of these literals. And we don't know a monotone example. Somehow, we need, in order to make the analysis, we have to move to non-monotone example, and although we know that it's not necessary. So it's not so easy to say what you will get if you will. I don't know. But you can monotonize it, but I cannot understand what you get. Now, there is another ingredient. There is a conjecture by Friedgut and by others that, you see, they didn't push it all the way to n over log n. They stopped at n over log square n. And there is several conjectures, or sort of a convincing array of conjectures, which says you cannot do better, n over log n square.
In step 3, do you put the most examples?
Yeah. You take with high probability. And in some sense, our example with Jeff, the new example, are similar to this. OK, so here is a result that I think it's useful to know in this context. And this is the result by Hastad, Bopana, LMN, Lina Al-Mansour, and Nissan, which said if you have a Boolean function which is represented by depth d size m Boolean circuits. So we talked about tribes, which is depth 2, and we talked about this example, which is depth 3. If you have such a function, then the total inference is small. And this is a very basic result in computational complexity. For example, this result implies that the majority function or the parity function cannot be described by bounded depth circuits. And the bounded depth circuits is a very nice gift of computer science to mathematics, because they are still things that we interact with other areas of mathematics. But more complicated complexity classes, we don't know how to. Okay, so what is the conclusion so far? In order to prove Shor conjecture, we need a method that will directly exploit inference of large sets. Okay, now I want to tell you another connection. This is part 3. So we have altogether 9 parts of this talk, but this is part 3. And no, don't worry. I mean, I will not go over time. But this is a connection
we allow,
that.
We allow interesting talks.
No. I mean, after I had this talk with Doron. Don Salber seminar has a very strict rule of 48 minutes. And the only thing I thought about doing the entire talk is not to cross this 48 minutes. Eventually, I finished after 47 minutes.
Yeah, also, here we have it, but it's a
Okay, so I want to tell you something which is interesting. Many of you know it. And this is the following. Suppose we have a family of sets. So okay, here are some notation, but if we have a family of sets and they are all subset of this set X, and now we talk inside X, we talk about a subset Y, so this is X, this is X, this is X, here we have the family, and here we have Y, this is Y, and then the trace of F on Y is just the intersection of the set in the family with this subfamily Y, with this subset Y. This is called the trace of the family on the subset. Okay, so this is a natural, if you think that families of sets are interesting, this is a natural thing to consider. Traces of families on subsets. And then the Sauer-Schellach theorem describes for every N and M, the minimal cardinality of a family which guarantees the existence of a subset Y of size M with complete trace. Complete trace means that every subset of Y is the intersection of Y with some set in the family. And this is called, if you have a family and you identify a Y with complete trace, you say that the family shatter this set Y. And this is a fairly basic notion, and here is the theorem. The theorem said if you have a family F, and if the number of elements in the family is greater or equal than N choose less or equal M, which is by definition this sum of binomial coefficient, then there exists a subset Y with M plus one element so that F shatter Y, okay? This is, so I'm sure most of you are familiar with this lemma. Okay, but maybe, unless I say it. Okay.
When you say, well, if you replace subsets of a set with Boolean vectors, what it says that if you have so many Boolean vectors of on n bits, then there is some set of coordinates of size n plus 1, so that all patterns that occur on this subset. So the vectors, when you just look at this coordinates, n plus 1 coordinates, shattering means you see all Boolean.
Yeah, right. The size of the largest set, which is shattered by a family of subsets, is called the VC dimension, Wapnick-Cherbonnex. It has a lot. It's very important in statistical learning theory. It is a very basic question. The theorem was proved. This theorem, actually, it's usually called the Sauer-Schellach lemma, but I call it. It was proved in a paper by Schellach, and there it's attributed to Schellach and Perles, and also in a paper by Sauer, and in a paper around the same time by Wapnick and Chervonenkis. And actually, Perles, the story is that Perles proved it twice independently, because 10 years later, he was asked by our colleague Benji Weiss from another motivation from ergodic theory about this lemma, and he forgot that he already proved it, and he proved it again. Now, if you want to prove it, so this is something it's useful to know. Let me tell you how to prove it. Here is the way to prove it. You start with a family. Now, this, first of all, this is tight, because if you take all the set of size less or equal m, then they cannot shatter a set of size m plus 1, right? And how to prove it is the following. You show that for every family f, the number of sets shattered by the family is at least the size of the family. Okay, now the sets shattered by the family is a collection of sets closed downwards. And if you have a collection of sets with more than this number of elements, it contains an element of size larger than m. Now, how do you prove that the family of sets shattered by the original family? Okay, so let's call the family of sets shattered by f, let's call it g. So g is the family of sets shattered by f, and f is the family, and you want to show that g is greater or equal to f. How do you prove this? You prove it by induction. How do you induct? So the standard way to induct is you consider all the sets which contain an element 1, you consider all the sets which miss the element 1. And from those sets which contain the element 1, you delete the element 1. So this gives you two families, f0 and f1, which are now from the elements 2 up to n. Or if you want, you can take the element n instead of 1. So from a family from n minus 1 set. And now we apply by induction this statement for each of these families. Okay, so we get that f1 is big, g1 is greater or equal to f1, g2 is greater or equal than f2. Ah, but there may be intersection, right? But if there is something which is both in g1 and g2, then you show that this set, you have both this set and the set where 1 is added are shattered by the original family. So this is the proof. I mean, you can do it by induction. Okay. So now let me move to the an arrow notation. So this is a way to describe a general statement of this question. We say that arrow capital M comma K means that for every family of subset of size N, we have a trace of size M or more on subset S of size K. Okay, so we were interested in the case. So every family of size N, capital N, from an N element set, we can find a set of size K where the trace has at least M element. And this is a formulation of the Sauer-Schellach theorem. And essentially the question about influence are question about almost complete trace. Instead, we don't want to shatter a set entirely. We want to shatter it up to 1 minus epsilon. So we don't want to get all the 2 to the k subset. We want to get 1 minus epsilon times 2 to the k. Now, the connection with influences, so the terminology for influence was obscure because I had something and I subtract this mu of f. Now I add it again, mu of f. It turns out that influences and traces are essentially the same thing. So I write the connection, but it's essentially the same problem. So the question about all these arrows, if we ask what are all the arrows that exist for families of sets, this includes the question that we asked before. This was considered in the extremal set theory by Peter Frankel and Nogalon and Adrian Bondi and other people. Okay, so now I want to tell you about counterexamples. And this will be the what we'll do. So, and I want to start with Bolobash and Radcliffe. And Bolobash and Radcliffe studied this arrow notation and the traces, and they ask maybe they make a very bold working conjecture. They said, maybe it's true that if we have the sum of binomial coefficient up to k plus 1 on n, if this is the size of the family, this implies a trace of this size, the sum of binomial coefficient up to m with m. Now, what is the rationale in such a conjecture? Because if you believe that the Hamming ball are optimal, then this is what the Hamming ball give you. If you take a Hamming ball, and then you take the trace on a set of m elements, you get on this on this set, you get a humming ball. So if the humming ball were the only examples, were the only legal examples in mathematics or in about collection of sets, this would be a true statement. So, okay. What? Okay, okay. So, okay, I'll slow down. But I just want to say that this is, the error notation is enough to be confusing and to lose me, but what the very dream could be that everything about traces follows from looking at humming balls. And if this dream would be correct, this will also imply our conjecture, Benny Shor conjecture, and the other conjectures I mentioned. Yes. Yeah, sure. Okay. Wait. This?
The definition of this inequality is like this: that if you have a set of capital N vectors of type N, when you look at there exists a subset of size K in which you have at least M capital N.
The question is that is there a connection to this theorem of single theorem of the Shiller inequality? Is there a connection between those two?
Yeah, the Shiller inequality is related to Harper. Shiller inequality is inequality about entropies. It's related to Harper theorem about the sum of the individual influences. And Shiller theorem tells you something similar, but when you go to larger sets, but the quality of the information is comparable to what you get from Harper theorem or the Loomis-Whitney theorem. So it's about this quality of information. So this gives you a more general thing which is related to Harper's theorem, but it doesn't give you stronger theorem like the log n over n, which comes from the KKL theorem. But we are also puzzled about the connection with entropy.
Is that Shiller and his examples tell you not about the existence of one set, but the average
right.
number of traces, and you are looking for a stronger result
right.
on one.
Right, so Shiller gave you about the average. Harper's theorem also gave you about the average, but and they are of similar flavor. Okay, so they ask themselves if this inequality holds, and actually when you look at it, the tribe example is a counter example when m is n minus one, but they didn't notice it, and this was good because they found another example, and their example is interesting. In any case, forget about the error notation. They found an example where the humming ball is not optimal when you move from a set on n element to a subset of n over 2 elements. In both these cases, the trace is very small. It's something like n to the power of k, and this is, but it shows that the humming ball is not optimal. Okay. Now, this is a result about with Saharon and me, and we ask ourselves, we already were interested in the case where you have almost complete shattering. You don't want to shatter a set of size m, you want to shatter it up to epsilon. And again, the hope was that the humming ball gives you the right answer. But we noticed that this is not the case. And the way we went about it is we look at a non-negative integer r. We look at the, so we have this peculiar example. We look at the, we took at random sets of size r from an n element set. And then we look at all the sets of size 2r that all their r subsets are in the family we started with. And this is our family of sets. And when you make the computation, you see that this have the trace of this, so you have a set with slightly less than power of m. So the conjecture would say that n to the power half m plus epsilon, or half plus epsilon times m, already almost shatter a set of size m. And we show that n to the power n minus delta doesn't even almost shatter, or even up to epsilon shatter a set of size m. So the humming ball intuition in this case is wrong, but this works when m is a constant and n go to infinity.
It is?
Yeah, maybe. So everything is a depth 2 circuit if you, but this. Yeah. Right. Yeah, so I think. Yeah, it is a sort of tribe because you want all of them to be there. So the tribes are all the R. Yeah, it is. It is. I didn't think about it, but this is cool.
So what's the claim is for all delta, or is it
the for all delta, for all delta and epsilon, for all delta and epsilon, which are positive, if n is if m is fixed and n is large enough, this already is false. So you don't, both of them you can give me. Okay. Delta, epsilon, this will not be true. Okay, so the new example with JF is, again, I cannot tell much about it. And essentially you take a collection, you take a tribe example, essentially a dual tribe example. Instead of variables, you talk about literal. So you do one of the tricks of ITI and lineal. It's only depth 2. You have to appropriate tune the size of the tribes, and you have to prove it afterwards. This is the difficult part. It's not so difficult, but it required some work, and somehow it worked. I don't know.
So they're intersecting the sets.
Yeah, of course. Yeah, you take sets of size C log n, and you take many such as. No, they are heavily intersecting, and this causes difficulties in proving things. And actually, in order to prove the things, you have to talk about literals and not about variables. Yeah, everything is chosen at random, and you proved with high probability. So I want to say, OK, so one possibility is that maybe KKL give you the only thing which is beyond Harper's theorem for traces question. And here is a question which we don't know to answer. And this is about function of measure n to the minus beta. Can we find functions of measure n to the minus beta with no sets of, say, 0.49 n of the variables with large influence? And we believe that n to the minus beta, we cannot find such a function, but n to the power of log n to the power of beta, then we can find. So we believe that the true answer is exponential in log n. So we believe that there is still one additional phenomena which is not covered by KKL. But again, morally, you cannot push things much beyond it. So you can find sets of size of measure, which is maybe not polynomially small, but polylog, exponential in polylog n small, with no large sets, which is high influential. And the reason we believe that there is still some phenomena to be discovered on the positive direction is precisely because of these conjectures by Friedgut and which related to the log n square that believed to be. So for sets of for Boolean function where the influence is precisely log n over n, we believe that they are very structured, and this will. Okay, maybe I'll skip this. This is a. Okay, so let me see what I want to say. So there are two more small things I want to say. So let me say the last thing is very simple. There are many cases in combinatorics, very famous case where the best way to prove theorems is by iterating the so-called density increasing method. And famous example is the Ross theorem, the Hale-Jewett theorem, the original Ross theorem, and Ross theorem for this way to the n. And usually the belief is that this method is very weak, and then, well, it's we can prove much better theorem, which match the existing examples. And, you know, so at least as a cheerleading, maybe one may think that also in this question, maybe we need to come back and look at example which will give us better lower bound. Of course, people don't need my advice to look in this direction, that direction, and this direction. But anyway, so. And the other is that this array of conjectures and results relate to another a nice question. Maybe I just mentioned the question. You have a random graph, and you ask, what is the critical probability for the, you have random graph, you have a property, and the property is to contain a copy of a specific graph, and you ask, what is the critical probability for this property? And of course, this is very difficult to, in many cases in random graph CO, it's very difficult to find it. And there is a naive way to go about it. And the naive way to go about it is to look at the highest probability Q for picking up the edges, so that every subgraph H prime of H, the expected number of copies of H prime will be at least 1/2. Okay, so this is very naive. So for example, if you want a Hamiltonian cycle, so it's not easy to find the critical probability for Hamiltonian cycle. But if you want to find a place that Hamiltonian, the expected number of Hamiltonian cycle is at least 1/2 or for any subgraph of it, then this is one over a constant over n, this is quite easy. And our conjecture is that, that the ratio between the easy thing to compute and the hard thing to compute is always less or equal than log n. So this is a very bold conjecture, but it turns out to be related to questions so there are two things to say. First of all, it is related to question about influences. And second, that if you think about the example which give you log n, like graph connectivity or Hamiltonian cycle, they have the flavor of dual tribe example. And we believe that somehow this dual tribe example is what's going on there in general. But you know, this is also a hope left to be shattered. Okay, so I'll quit here.